coming and welcome to our seminar in our PhD program on statistics, applied mathematics and optimization. And it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Jan Rückmann from the University of Bergen in Norway. The first time we met him was in Mexico, before, in Washington in 1998. And the second time I met him was in my thesis committee, by the way. And we have met several times, our groups. In this sense, he's an old colleague. And it's our pleasure to have him here. Just some numbers. He's author of about 70 papers. 49 can be found in MathSciNet, and I also found 292 sites by 170 authors, which is a measure of the repercussion. I always like to say these numbers. So thank you very much. I haven't I can say more things. He is a big traveler. Has been not only in Germany, but 6 years in Mexico, 6 years in Birmingham, in the UK, and now, as I said before, he's in Norway. So it's our pleasure to have you here, and we are yours. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Juan. And thanks for the very kind and nice introduction. I also thought about it when we met, and we talked about that, that we met the first time in Washington in 98. But if I go a little bit back, then I think we met, Miguel and Marco, we met the first time in Twente in 95. It was 3 years before, and then you invited me kindly to Alicante to come in 96. And then we met in different spaces and states. Okay, today I would like to talk about, you can read the title here, Max Type Objective Functions, a Smoothing Procedure in Strongly Stable Stationary Point. This is a joint paper together with Paco Guerra Vasquez from Universidad de las Americas in Mexico. We were colleagues some years together. And also from Willy Weber from the Middle East Technical University, MITU, in Ankara in Turkey. And we just talked about, it is not clear how the situation is there at the moment, but I only got the information that he is okay, and the times are complicated. Okay, so let's see if it works here. No?
I think it's in the other way.
No,
I saw that way, okay.
Turn on, just hit turn on.
Can you to switch it on? Okay, that's a good idea. Yeah, okay. So a brief outline here. So I will give an introduction, the problem formulation, then present some basic results. And then I will talk about stationary points, strongly stable stationary points, the relations between the original problem, between those of the original problem and those of the approach problem. And then finally, I will say some global remarks about properties of the feasible set. So what is the problem formulation? We are looking at a finite dimensional problem with a max type objective function. So a max type objective function is a function of this type here. Is that working with a, yeah. So we have the maximum about a continuously differentiable function, vk is c2, gi, the other constraints here are also c2, because we will need first and second order derivatives. And you will see in a moment why I call the variable vector x tilde, and from x1 to xn minus 1. We are looking to problems with finitely sets here, so finitely many indices, we have finitely many constraints here, and we have finitely many functions which appear in the max parentheses. And max type means we have different functions like that, also v1, v2, and v3, and our function of interest capital F of x tilde here is the maximum of them. So it means from the intuition it's clear if they are convex, then this function is also convex, and so on. But we will not focus here on convex functions. Okay, the trick is that we can formulate this problem as an equivalent C2 problem by introducing a new variable, xn. So that's why this is a missing component here of a vector in Rn. And that's why we call it x tilde for the first n components. And then the nth component, the extra one, appears here. And you see that this is equivalent in the sense of the feasible sets are equivalent when we put this extra component into account here. So it means we have a minimum of a very special objective function, xn, the nth component of the variable vector x. And then the other ones are all C2 functions. That means what we will do is here we switch to a C2 problem. And of course you can ask now, why is he introducing the max type function when he is switching in the first slide to the C2 problem? We will look at the C2 problem, and this special structure plays an important role in the demonstrations of the theorems, of the results, which I will not present here, of course. So this is the reason for mentioning that. So what we are doing now is the following. We will consider a finite dimensional C2 problem in the standard way. So we minimize the function f subject to a finite number of inequality constraints. This is a feasible set. We assume that the n is not empty, otherwise it's not interesting. And all the functions here are assumed to be twice continuously differentiable. And what we are doing is we will consider a family of interior point approximations of m using a logarithmic barrier function. So that's a standard approach when you make an interior point approach, that you say, okay, from the inside I approach my feasible set. And the trick is then, we will come back to this in more details in a moment, but let me say as a motivation this basic property. So if we have several constraints, then we have, that's very well known, so we have a boundary which is non-smooth. If there are two constraints which are meet here, then the boundary is non-smooth. And the idea now is to approach this feasible set from the interior by a smooth boundary, by a set which we call, we will see that in a moment, M gamma. Gamma refers to this difference between the original set and the approximation set. And this feasible set M gamma has a smooth boundary, so we can treat it much better than the original boundary. And what we will see then is, what is the relationship, or which kind of properties relate between those of M and those of M gamma. So that means, let us define the set M0, the set of those points where we have no active constraints. So it means here from the picture, it is the interior of the set. If it is not, if the interior is empty, then we cannot do anything. Yeah, so that means it makes sense to say that this is a non-empty set. And then what we will do is, for defining this one function which has this red boundary, where the function is equal to 0. This is defined, as we know, from the interior point approach. We take the sum of the logarithm of gj of x, so gj were the constraints, and then we say, okay, this new defined function here, this sum, is greater than or equal the logarithm of gamma. So gamma is, of course, a positive number, and it depends on gamma, how far away this red set is from the boundary of the original set. Okay? The point is, what I already said, we have a single constraint, namely that one, and we call this gamma, which appears here as a superindex, the approximation parameter. And assuming that the Mangesheim-Fromowitz constraint qualification holds at all points of the original set, then this set where the new constraint is active, so where we have this, gx is equal to ln gamma, is a smooth approximation of the boundary. Okay, so this is at the moment only a geometric intuition, an impression. What we mean with smooth approximation, we will see later in a mathematical way. The question is always why we take the logarithm here. The reason is that here. We can also take the product of the gj, but this is for taking derivatives and so on, easier to take the sum, but then we need the logarithm here. Okay, so we have two objectives of this lecture. The first objective is a more local one, and the second objective is a more global one. So what the first one is the following. For the global one, we look at a stationary point, or we can say all stationary points, but the main, if we say one stationary point and then we generalize to all, we will assume that this stationary point has a so-called strong stability property, which refers to unitness and existence of a stationary point locally around it. And then we will show that there is a one-to-one correspondence between stationary points of P and the approach problem. So it means if we have here a stationary point, which is strongly stable in that sense, I will define that later on, what I mean with this here. So that is locally, uniquely determined with respect to existence and uniqueness, you know, in the neighborhood. Then for some or for all sufficiently small gamma, we have a corresponding stationary point for the approach problem, for the approaching problem. There is a one-to-one correspondence, as I say there, between stationary points of the original problem and of the approach problem. And they have also the same stationary index. This is a number of negative negative eigenvalues of the restricted Hessian of the Lagrangian, and it determines in a unique way which type of stationary point we are looking at. Is it local minimizer, is it a saddle point, or is it a local maximizer? And the first step in this direction was done in a paper from 2001 by Paco Gerla, Harald Günzel, and Bert Jongen, when there was assumed non-degeneracy. So under non-degeneracy, everything can done using the implicit function theorem. We will look at the more general case of strong stability. That means strong stability is weaker than non-degeneracy. There we need not, for example, the linear independence constraint qualification and neither the strict complementarity. Of course, some properties must be fulfilled as well. We know that strong stability implies the Mangesheim form of its constraint qualification. That means the interesting case is what happens if the Mangesheim form of its constraint qualification is fulfilled but not the linear independence constraint qualification. And as a completing remark here, that the strong stability and the strong regularity in the sense of Robinson, 1980, he defined that for generalized equations, is the same under linear independence constraint qualification. So if I go back, this was objective number one, that we say we have a one-to-one relationship between the stationary points of the original problem and those of the approximation problem. And the objective two is a more global consideration. We are looking now not only at the stationary points, at solutions in some sense, but we are looking to the feasible set. And we say now, that is what we said, I said in the beginning as an intuitive approach, that I say M gamma is an, the red one is a smooth approximation of the original feasible set. What does it mean? So that is stated here now. It means in the house, using the Hausdorff matrix, then M gamma is converging to M. So when gamma goes to zero, then this red boundary is approaching the original boundary, and both sets are homeomorphic. Okay, so let us start to look at these two objectives. by presenting some basic results. So first, let me say something about what means strong stability of a stationary point. The first time it was introduced by Kojima in 1980 for finite optimization problems. We generalized this at the end of the 90s also for semi-infinite programs. And it refers mainly to the local existence and uniqueness of a stationary point for any sufficient small perturbed problem, sufficiently small perturbed problem. So what does it mean, sufficiently small perturbed? In the next slide, I will present the technical definition. But let me say it first in words. Perturbation means we allow perturbations up to second order. So we say, OK, sufficiently small with respect to the value of the function, with respect to the first derivative, and with respect to the second order derivative, which are allowed here. And the second point is that the perturbation depends continuously. The stationary point of the perturbed problem depends continuously on the perturbation. So if the perturbation is small, then it is not going so far away, and so on. Continuity in the classical sense. And if we write this down as Kojima did, then he came to this definition here. So we call a stationary point strongly stable if there exists a neighborhood of this point. Also, if we look at this point here, x, then we say, okay, we have here a neighborhood, b delta bar of x bar, such that within this neighborhood, and if the perturbation is small enough, this is hidden here with this norm definition. I didn't write this here, it's very technical. So, but what I said, yeah, we are looking at perturbations of the functions themselves, of the first order derivatives and the second order derivatives, then the perturbed problem, so we have the perturbations here, f tilde and g tilde, are within this neighborhood, and it is unique in this neighborhood. Now there must be one, and there is only one. And of course, this second delta here means a continuity. Also, if we make the perturbation smaller, then we can also we find this point in a smaller neighborhood. But within B delta bar, the uniqueness is guaranteed.
Sure,
yes.
It means norm of F bar G one bar, comma the ball.
Moment. Whenever we have such a perturbation okay. with this. Then this ball contains.
Yes, but what this stands for me is this special norm of one vector of perturbations, comma, the ball.
Moment. If for some delta, and each delta, you can write here then. Then it's perhaps more clear.
No, but how is it defined the norm?
The norm of one vector, one ball.
Ah, okay, okay. You want to know the definition of norm?
No, because I say one vector is clear. You have one vector of perturbations, is clear, but you have comma one ball.
Yes, it is an, yeah, okay, I understand. You mean this comma and not this?
Okay. No problem.
No, it's clear. So, okay, two things, then we go deeper. the point is, I took here exactly the definition from Kojima, and he says it is not a norm, it's a semi-norm. But I didn't want to mention that here too. But the point is, he is measuring this value of these functions, as well as the value of the first order derivatives and the value of the second order derivatives within this ball. This ball. What happens outside is not interesting. Yes. Yeah. No, but it's fine. No, it's fine. Yeah. So, but the question is, of course, now, as we have seen, with this definition, we cannot work. Yeah, this is not, we cannot handle it. And what Kojima then did in this famous paper was an algebraic characterization of this strong stability. So that means we have this topological definition here, which is okay. which we can use for demonstrations, but we cannot work with this, we cannot check this. So what he did was an equivalent characterization in an algebraic way under constraint qualification. So he made an, I will talk about that in a moment. He said, if Mangazayan Fomowitz constraint qualification is fulfilled, then we can equivalently characterize strong stability in the following way, and the same he did for linear independence constraint qualification. Also under the linear independence constraint qualification, there he showed that we can find an equivalence between this algebraic characterization and the topological definition, a topological characterization. What he didn't say, and that's why I mentioned that in the beginning, what was then done later by Jung and Günzel-Gerrer, is to show that for strong stability we really need Mangazayan Fromowitz constraint qualification. So there is no other case. Yeah, that was not clear in the paper with Kojima. Is there perhaps a case where we have strong stability but not Mangazayan Fromowitz constraint qualification? But there is not. And let's talk about this algebraic characterization now. Also, if we have the linear independence constraint qualification at the point under consideration, then of course we have uniquely determined multipliers, Lagrange multipliers, and we can define the Hessian here of the Lagrangian. So these are the corresponding Lagrange multipliers. That means the first derivative is equal to zero. And we look at these sets of those Lagrange multipliers which were strictly positive. That is a difference to the non-degenerate case, no? That these sets J0, the active constraints, and those which are strictly positive can be different. Okay, so there, if they are different, then we have some intermediate index sets here, and we can look at the corresponding tangent space here. So for all intermediate index sets capital I, which are varying between J plus, the set of strictly positive Lagrange multipliers, and those which are active, is defined here. So that is not yet a characterization, it is only a definition. If we have the weaker condition, Mangazayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification, then we know that this set of Lagrange multipliers is not uniquely, need not to be uniquely determined, which means we have normally a compact set of Lagrange multipliers, and we have to define then this Hessian of the Lagrangian depending on the Lagrange multiplier. So if you go back here to compare both, so A here is not depending on the Lagrange multiplier because it's uniquely determined, but for the Mangazayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification, we have to look at this Hessian of the Lagrangian in dependence on this Lagrange multiplier. And for each of them, for each lambda bar, we can define here the corresponding tangent space, which is only taking into account those elements, those coefficients of lambda, which are strictly positive. So this is our setting for the algebraic characterization. As we have the Hessian, and we have the corresponding tangent spaces here. And then we get the following, the theorem by Kojima was the following. So we assume that we have a stationary point, and then we got this CSE equivalence. Okay, so on the left-hand side we have this definition, topological definition, X bar is a strongly stable stationary point. And then we say that the sign of the determinant of the Hessian restricted to the tangent space is constant and non-vanishing. So it means it's all are one or all are minus one. Yeah, so we have a so-called coherent orientation of these restricted Hessians for all intermediate index sets between J plus, the set of positive Lagrange multipliers, and the active Lagrange multipliers. So this is a very famous theorem, and we can make a step further here. We can say if this is constant and non-vanishing, yeah, so again in literature sometimes they say the determinants have a covariant orientation, then it is easy to see that the number of negative eigenvalues is the same for all of these restricted Hessians. And this number of eigenvalues is called the stationary index of X bar. And we have this characterization of the stationary index is that it gives us an unique information which type of stationary point we have here. That's also well known. So if the stationary index is zero, the number of negative eigenvalues is zero, then X bar is a local minimizer. If it is equal to n, then we have a local maximizer. Well, that means if we have no active constraint, and all the intermediate cases refer to a saddle point. This is well known. That is a generalization of the Morse index. If we have only one function from the 60s, or the quadratic index, there are several indices which go in the same direction and which are always saying something about the type of the solution of the stationary point we are considering it. So this is a case, I go back for a moment here, that is a case if we have the linear independence constraint qualification that was shown by Kojima, and he also showed that if we assume that the Mangazar-Fromowitz constraint qualification is fulfilled but not LICQ, yeah, so this is the second case here, then we can equivalently characterize the strong stability, the topological property of strong stability, by the fact that we have no negative and no zero eigenvalue. This means N and O here, so we have the inertia triple, negative, zero, and positive eigenvalues must be zero. So it means all eigenvalues are positive, which means we have a local minimizer. In that case, we can define SI as a stationary index equal to zero. Also if MFCQ is fulfilled but not LICQ, then that must always be a local minimizer if it is strongly stable. Okay, so that is this is our was a famous theorem, and we can also prove a little bit more that we have here also a strict local minimizer. If we have strong stability, then it's a little bit more. It's not only a local minimizer, but it is a little bit more. So I will show two lemmas in order to show a little bit which kind of tools we are using here in order to prove our results. So far that was Kojima, 35 years ago. What we will look at is the following. Kojima said, okay, we have a problem here, the black one, the original one, and we perturb a little bit, and if it is strongly stable, then this perturbed problem has also locally a uniquely determined and a stationary point. What we will do now is to say, okay, we will not perturb these original functions. What we will do is we will approximate this problem by a problem with a feasible set M gamma. That means we have one constraint, so we have a smooth boundary, and then the question is, what gives us the strong stability of the original solution for the solutions of the problem of approximation here? Yeah, that is our question. And in order to investigate that, we use here a lot of matrix algebra, that is clear, because we are using, of course, the algebraic characterization. And in order to show what is used here, I will present here two lemmas to familiarize a little bit with these tools. So let us look at the following construction. We have a quadratic matrix A, here the submatrix NN, and we have C of dimension KK, symmetric matrices. Then we have a matrix B, which is of dimension KN, and we have an M-dimensional subspace W, as well as an orthogonal subspace defined by using the matrix rows of B. And for this n-dimensional subspace, we also defined the corresponding orthogonal subspace given in this standard way here. Then, what we will mainly use here is inertia theorems. So inertia, the inertia triple of a matrix, it's inertia of a matrix is the set of positive eigenvalues, zero eigenvalues, and negative eigenvalues. Okay? And we will use this in order to find characterizations for the stationary index. So the stationary index is a number of negative eigenvalues of the corresponding matrix. So in order to get these, we have to look at some inertia theorems. So the inertia of the whole matrix here is the inertia of A plus the inertia of this so-called Schur complement of E1. So Schur complement, you see that, is a C minus B inverse of A times BT. Yeah? We have non-singularity of A here assumed, so we can define here the Schur complement. And if we have a non-singular matrix and we have that A restricted to the subspace of W is equal to zero, then we can split the inertia of A, again, this inertia is always the eigenvalues, number of eigenvalues, positive, zero, and negative. And we can find the following, the inertia of A restricted to a subspace plus the inertia of the inverse of A restricted to the orthogonal subspace gives us the inertia of whole A. Well, not here, it's not A, it's A to the power of minus one. And if C is equal to zero, let us come back to the construction here. So if C is zero, then we have exactly the matrix which we get from the standard Karasch-Kontakte conditions. Yeah, so we have here A, it's our Hessian, and then we have here the gradients of the active constraints. And this is then always the question, how can we characterize this A restricted to the tangent space in terms of PA as of the number of positive zero and negative eigenvalues. And we get this, the following, oh, this is exactly that here. The inertia of Hessian restricted to the tangent space, this is what we are interested in. That can be obtained by inertia of E1, or of the Hull matrix, this one. And then we got here some K1, and K minus K1. So it means K1 is a rank of B. So if we have linear independence, then this here is zero. Yeah, so I have to take care. I changed here the order. It must be N and O. Yeah, so we have here zero. There's no eigenvalue which is equal to zero. So this is one important theorem or a lemma from matrix algebra. The second thing is strong stability refers, as I said, to the property of coherent orientation of all matrices. All matrices have the same sign, which is either one or minus one, not zero. Okay, so that means something must be positive definite in the difference. Okay, what I mean with this is the following. So let us look at the second matrix, which is also similar to that matrix we get from the standard Karasch-Kontakte conditions. So if we have symmetric matrix A, we can imagine that is again the Hessian of our Lagrangian. And then we have two submatrices, B1 and B2 here. So could be, for example, B1 could be the matrix with those gradients of active constraints which belong to positive Lagrange multipliers. And this is a rest. These are those which belongs to the zero Lagrange multipliers. So that means we are looking at all matrices without the B2 or the Hull or any intermediate matrix. So we take any selection of columns of B2 in order to look at these matrices. And then we got the following. If we have that the number of negative eigenvalues of A with respect to the first part of the matrix, B1, and the number of zero eigenvalues is equal to zero, then strong stability means exactly that this matrix here is positive definite. So this is technical, I will not go here into details, but I only want to illustrate here that with this we got a consequence of the algebraic characterization of strong stability, which we will use here later. But don't worry, I will not present any proofs here. Okay, so having said this, so having said something about the tools we are using here, I would say now we come to these relations between stationary points. So as again, our question is, what can we say between these two? What we want, of course, is, and what we will also get at the end, is that we have a one-to-one relationship. So that means that we have the strong stability between here and here is a maintained property if gamma is sufficiently small. We will, as Kojima did, we will consider two cases now. So we will say LICQ is fulfilled, and we have a point which is strongly stable, and then LICQ is not fulfilled, but the Mangazin-Fromowitz constraint qualification is fulfilled. And as I already said, there are no other cases. Yeah? What we know now, so it means we only have to investigate these two cases, and then we get this what we want, namely, assume that we have a strongly stable stationary point, and assume first case that the linear independence constraint qualification holds at x bar. Then there exists such a neighborhood, okay, b delta bar, as well as gamma, for all gamma sufficiently small, such that we have a point x gamma here, x gamma, and which is the only stationary point, so now my neighborhood is too small, I have to make it bigger. Oh, I have to put my red line a little bit nearer. So let's say this is our b delta gamma. And both have the same stationary index. I come to this later because this is interesting why this is the case, because stationary index depends on the number of active constraints. And here we have only one, always. You know, that is another byproduct, that this point is always on the boundary. It is not inside. So that means have the same stationary index means, as we have seen, stationary index characterizes in a unique way which type of stationary point we have. Is it a local minimizer? Is it a saddle point? Or is it a local maximizer? And we have more, namely that we have a continuously differentiable mapping. So that means if we let gamma go to zero, which means if we have that this red boundary is approaching the original boundary, then we get such an interior path which goes to the original point. And we can also say something about the, remember we have exactly one constraint active here, which has a corresponding Lagrange multiplier. And if you have only one, then LICQ and MFCQ is the same. Yeah. So it's uniquely determined and it goes to zero. Okay. So this is what we want. Let me say three small comments about it. So we have to show three things. We have to show the existence of such a point. We have to show that it is unique in order to get the corresponding strong stability property. And we have to show that the indices are the same. Yeah, so these are the three things which are stated. And I will only say existence part is only a comment here, namely which kind of perturbation are we doing? What are we taking here into account? We are perturbing the right-hand sides of all except one active constraints there. And one of these active constraints we perturb by an epsilon divided by Zx, divided by the product of all those which are non-active there. That is a trick which is used here for the existence part. But of course, this is very technical and very long. The stationary index part, again, this is, I already mentioned it briefly. This is interesting because the dimension of the tangent space for P gamma is always n minus 1 because we have exactly one active constraint. So it means the number of eigenvalues of this matrix is n minus 1, where the number of eigenvalues of this point here, of the original point, is n minus cardinality of the set of active constraints. So that means this difference between n minus 1 and number of n minus cardinality of active constraints is not changing the number of negative eigenvalues. Yeah, so these kind of are positive all. Okay, and we come now to the Mangesayan-Fromowitz case. So it means we assume the second statement that we have not the linear independence constraint qualification fulfilled here, but the Mangesayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification. Then we got a very similar statement. So we got the same picture in the, as an illustration. But of course, we are losing the differentiability of this path. Yeah? So Mangesayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification takes away the differentiability. And the rest is the same, almost. We have, of course, since we have Mangesayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification, we have that the index is zero. We always have here local minimizers. If Mangesayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification, but not linear independence, then we have always local minimizer, which means we have here the stationary index is equal to zero. And here's the same thing. We have only one active constraint here in the red, in the approximating problem, and perhaps much less in the original problem. And we have that here. We have a continuous statement, not differentiable, where mu gamma is the Lagrange multiplier for x gamma. And finally, let me say something about global properties of the feasible set. So we had two objectives, as you remember. The first thing was this local consideration of stationary points. And now we come to the global properties of the feasible set. So the first thing is a corollary. It's a straightforward. No? If we have not one, but we have more, and we make the same consideration for all of these under the assumption that all of them are strongly stable. Well, this is what we say here. So all of the stationary points are strongly stable. So then we can find, of course, the minimum of all over all gammas such that we find a positive gamma such that for all gamma between in this interval, we have a one-to-one correspondence between stationary points of P and of the P gamma. And corresponding stationary points have the same stationary index. So that's a straightforward implication of that result we saw before. And if we now leave the consideration of stationary points, of solutions, but look now at the feasible set, then we say the following. If the feasible set is compact, and it is all, and we assume the Mangesayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification holds at all x of m, Mangesayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification, convex is Slater, it is equivalent to topological stability, equivalent to metric irregularity. This is a very important property. Then we have that this Mangesayan-Fromowitz constraint qualification is also valid for the red set, m gamma. Yeah, intuitively, that's clear. And both sets are homeomorphic. So topologically, they are the same. Topologically, they are equivalent. And m gamma converges to m in the Hausdorff matrix as gamma goes to zero. Hausdorff matrix is defined here. So here we assume we have assumed one thing, namely that we have that m is compact. So if we go back to our construction in the beginning with the max type function, then M is not compact because it is open. It's an epigraph like set, but it can be used, it can be shown in the same way, because this epigraph set is of course very similar. It has very particular properties, let me say it in that way, very particular properties, and we got the same statement about convergence between M gamma and M, and homeomorphy between M and M gamma. But if we, as we did now, look at a C2 problem, then it is better to say M is compact. Then we lose, or we need not to take into account any asymptotic behavior at infinity. So, yeah. We can make it easier to say what happens at infinity, but the version which avoids unnecessary technicalities is to assume that we have here compactness of M. And that was all what I wanted to tell you. Thank you very much.